Before we worship this morning, let us read from the book of Psalm 104, verses 10 through 15. He makes springs pour water into the ravines. It flows between the mountains. They give water to all the beasts of the field. The wild donkeys quench their thirst. The birds of the sky nest by the waters. They sing among the branches. He waters the mountains from his upper chambers. The land is satisfied by the fruit of his work. He makes grass grow for the cattle and plants for the people from the earth. Bringing forth food from the earth, wine that gladdens human hearts, oil to make their faces shine, and bread that sustains their hearts. These are God's words for God's people. Let us pray. Dear Lord, help us to build a world where all workers are valued, a world where those who clean houses are able to buy houses to shelter in, a world where those who grow food can afford to eat their fill. We pray for a world where all workers everywhere share in the abundance that you have blessed us. We ask these things knowing that you have given us the courage and the strength to live out our faith in the workplace and in the marketplace, as well as here in the sanctuary. May we labor for you, ever committed to do your word in the world. These things we pray in the name who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive those our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Fill out a tiny little form that's in the back of the church. It's in a little container with pencils in there, and it is for the financial committee to decide whether or not you want envelopes for offering or if you wish to maintain online. We're trying to keep costs down a little bit because so many envelopes in the past have not been utilized and have just been tossed. So if you didn't fill it out last week, please make sure you do this week. Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks, Karen. Thank you, Karen. We've had a very interesting week this week, haven't we? Scary at times and hard work. So I'm going to keep things a little short, but I have something really special I want to talk to you about in a few minutes. First of all, next Sunday, nobody's going to be here. We're all meeting at Alverthorpe Park in Abington. If you haven't yet picked up directions, there's a blue sheets on the back table. Please pick up decorations. There are decorations. Directions. Well, you can pick up a few decorations if you want to, but I don't think there's anything back there. Anyway, pick up a sheet with the directions. They're very specific because you don't enter at the main entrance. So if you haven't picked them up, please do that this morning. All food will be provided, including dessert. So there will be no dessert contest this year. And there will be no bus transportation. So if you need a ride, please contact Deb Clark. we'll work things out. Nobody should stay home because they don't have a ride. We can work that out for you. So please let somebody know, Deb especially, but if you have a friend that comes, ask the friend, whatever works. We want to see everyone there. So that's number one. Another reminder is this Saturday, September 18th, that's not this coming, but the week after, is craft night to make one of these cute little hedgehogs from a book. And if you're interested in that, please sign up so we know how many people to prepare for. Now, as some of you came in, I'm sure you noticed that there were little pieces of post-it notes on one of the bulletin boards out in the lobby, and that there was a pile of stuff on a table in the narthex. More than 2,000, and probably more coming, Afghani refugees have been processed through Philadelphia International Airport. The United States Coast Guard Atlantic Strike Team, based at McGuire Dix Lakehurst in New Jersey, are accepting specific goods and materials to donate directly to incoming refugees. The Gray family is asking for your help to meet this endeavor. Written cards are out in the lobby with specific items. Please don't get creative. You know, if it says a red playground ball, that's what they want. If it says a soccer ball, don't bring a baseball. I mean, you know, there are specific reasons. This is a wonderful way to show God's love for all people. Most of these people, my guess is, are Muslim. So they have specific dress codes, specific food codes, and the needs are really very specific. There is also on the table in the back a sheet of items that are listed that may or may not be on the wall. The ones on the wall you can take home as put on your refrigerator as a reminder. But there are other options. There are very few things for women because a lot of these women have very specific dress. So, and please, they're requesting new things, but also some things that are gently used. Please clean them before you donate them. I don't want to be insulting to anybody, but I have been on the receiving end a few times when we've had to sort through things that were donated because they weren't clean. So there's a huge variety, and again, please don't deviate from the list. And I think that's pretty much it. Obviously, no shorts and tank tops. Hats they're recommending if you have some knitted ones or in the process of knitting a couple for another project we're doing and you want to donate them to this project now and make others for the Christmas project, that's fine too. Whatever you can do to help would be a wonderful statement of God's love reaching out to people who have nothing but what they had on their backs when they left. So talk about starting from scratch. You can see. If you have any questions about anything, Heather Gray is not here this morning, but I'm sure you can call her or text her if you have any questions about any of the items or if you think of something that maybe you think should be on this list. Please don't buy it or bring it unless you get her approval. Very specific needs. Our church has been so wonderful about reaching out and helping. And I know we've had some major disasters in our local area, but at this point, we don't know what those needs are. But we know what these needs are. So as things come to us, we will address them. The last date that we will accept things for the Afghani refugees is September the 26th. That's a Sunday. So you have a few weeks, a couple weeks, whatever, to bring things in or to bring them directly to the church, if not on a Sunday. I'm guessing that Grays are going to take a load, whatever they can, you know. If a lot of stuff comes in, they may have to make two trips or two vehicles, but that is the last day. So this is a very short, don't think, you know, well, I'll wait until it's October, because October will be too late. So, and the need is desperate for right now. So I appreciate all of you and encourage you all to participate in some way. Thank you.
Will you stand and join us in singing, "Come, Now Is the Time to Worship"?
Thank you. Our Heavenly Father, we do come. We've come to worship. We've come to stand before you and to find in your presence all we need for life and godliness. May today be a day when we know we've been in your presence, and may we be transformed amidst even the storms that we face. For it's in the name of Christ we pray. Amen. I want to share with you our scripture from the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah chapter 3. We're going to be reading verses 1 and 2 and 13 and 14. And I was asked to read it because it's a little bit unusual and also because there are a lot of names. Eliashib, the high priest, and his fellow priests went to work and rebuilt the sheep gate. They dedicated it and set its doors in place, building as far as the Tower of the Hundred, which they dedicated, and as far as the Tower of Hananel. The men of Jericho built the adjoining section, and Zakur, son of Imri, built next to them. And then we have a listing of all the other walls that were built until we get to verses 13 and 14. We read that the valley gate was repaired by Hanan and the residents of Zenoa. They built it and put its doors in place with their bolts and bars. They also repaired 1,000 cubits of the wall as far as the dung gate. Now the dung gate was repaired by Malchijah, son of Rechab, ruler of the district of Beth Hakkerim. He built it, and he put its doors in place with their bolts and bars. How would you like to be known as the one who had the privilege of building the dung gate? Yeah, you can giggle. That's okay. I share this text because we're at Labor Day weekend, and I'm going to ask how many of you at times have felt like you were working on the dung gate? But here's what I want you to see. That was a very significant and dignified task. Had to be done. And the person who did it was actually memorialized in the scripture. Whatever you're doing, in work or deed, do it all for the glory of God. And that's all I'm going to say about that right now. But I would invite you to join together as we sing the congregational hymn, O Jesus, I Have Promised.
It's number 369 if you're using the hymn book. And there's three verses. We'll sing all three. And I'll ask you to stand as we sing.
See the sights that dazzle the town.
As we prepare together today to explore the Word of God, we also want to thank God for the blessings He's given us. There are so many concerns that are on each of our hearts. We pray for the schools that are trying to get started right now, for the large number of people who've been impacted by COVID at this time, for individuals who have lost multiple family members, for two congregations in our region in the west part of the state who've lost pastors, and one that lost their pastor and his wife within 1 hour of one another in the same ICU. Got to take this thing seriously, folks, because it really is. That's why I appreciate your wearing masks and seeking to be as safe as possible. In addition, of course, the loss from Wednesday has been so dramatic. Be in prayer for the Upper Dublin School District where Cheryl works. I'm sure you've all seen pictures of the high school. The elementary school where Cheryl is was hit even harder. And the children will be going to other schools for the next few weeks at least. So be in prayer for them, for their teachers, for the excitement that was there that now is confusion and sorrow as they try to figure out what's going to be next. Also pray for the families who lost home and lives in our region, along the Louisiana coast, in New Jersey, and in New York City. It's been a difficult time. I'd also ask you to pray for those who have evacuated from Afghanistan, and that the simple acts that we're going to be able to share with them will show them the love of Christ and will open their hearts to hear a message of grace, of welcome, and of God's peace, even in the midst of the kind of confusion and disruption that they're all feeling. So let's go to the Lord together. We will thank Him for what He's done in our lives, for the gifts He's given, and bring these concerns before Him as well. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we gather now, we would bring before You the concerns that are so deep on our hearts. We think of those in our own community who have lost so much. May they find hope in You and in Your people who reach out and demonstrate love. We pray for those who have left home and are now strangers in a strange land. I pray that through Your people, they may find a home, a place of welcome, and a new beginning. We pray for our schools as they get underway. Pray that You would shield them from additional disruption. as we read of schools in other parts of the country that are closing for COVID. May our children be able to have some consistency. For the children of districts like Upper Dublin who don't have a school at this moment, guide them as they go into new territory. And then, Father, bring comfort to those who are grieving right now. Churches and families, neighbors, and loved ones. May your peace be made known to them, and may your love be shared with them through the people around. Father, we thank you for the gifts that are given so frequently, whether for Afghan refugees or for people who have experienced loss in Haiti or in Louisiana or in our own area, and for the gifts that are given for the work of ministry here at Hatboro Baptist. Thank you for the sacrifice that's represented in those gifts. And may you take and use them for your glory today and in the days to come. Through Jesus I pray. Amen. The scripture that we've prepared for you today comes from from Ephesians 6 and Genesis 2. And you'll learn about Mark 4 in a moment. It's Labor Day weekend, and so we read, "Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but as slaves of Christ, doing the will of God in your heart, serve wholeheartedly, as if you were serving the Lord and not people, because you know that the Lord will reward each one for whatever good they do, whether they are free or slave. And masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Do not threaten them, since you know that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and there is no favoritism with him." And then from Genesis 2, "So the heavens and the earth were completed in all their vast array. And by the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work." This is the text from which I've been planning to preach this weekend for about a month and a half. I wanted to encourage you to see your work, whether at home, in employment, in agencies where you volunteer, in your neighborhood, to be more than the stuff you do, and understand it instead as that which is worship to God. The work you do is worship. Whatever we do in word or deed, we do it all for the glory of God. Give some reflection to that this week. But I've got to tell you, after the events of this week, the Holy Spirit spoke to me on Wednesday and said, we need to address some storms. And so if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Mark chapter 4, verses 35 to 41. It won't be on the screen. If you have a pew Bible, it's page 39 in the New Testament, so in the second set of numbers. Follow as we read. "On that day when evening had come, Jesus said to them, 'Let us go across to the other side.' And leaving the crowd behind, they took with them in the boat, just took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Now other boats were with him, and a great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we're perishing?" And he woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and fear and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" May God bless his word to our hearts today. On August 15, a storm struck Kabul. As the Taliban entered the city, the American embassy moved to the airport. Thousands of Afghans and foreign nationals streamed to the airport to leave the city. The following 2 weeks were a storm of activity and violence that few of us have seen and read about and heard about in our lives. Fear drove the evacuation. On Monday of this week, the last military transport left Kabul. And yet the storm has not ended. In 10 days, we're going to mark 18 months since Hatboro Baptist Church first closed our doors to in-person worship. Since then, the storm of SARS-CoV-2 has turned our lives upside down. With 660,000 deaths in our country and at least 4,550,000 deaths around the world, life has changed for all of us in one way or another. Fear has become a constant companion for many. We're gathering for worship again, but the storm has not ended. And then on Wednesday, the remnants of Hurricane Ida passed through our area with 12 hours of devastating storms. At least 7 tornadoes tore through our neighborhoods, destroying homes, schools, businesses, and lives. The winds may be gone and the sun may be shining and it's beautiful weather today, but the storms continue to rage in the lives and neighborhoods as fear of an uncertain future swirls through people's minds and lodges in their hearts. But these are only a few of the storms that we face. This week I heard from a friend who had lost 3 relatives to COVID in the last few weeks. As I mentioned earlier, a pastor and his wife in Western Pennsylvania died within an hour of one another, leaving that church bereft and in deep grief. I recently spoke to a man who had not been able to sleep for weeks because he's dealing with a broken heart over a relationship that he cannot put back together. Another spoke of estrangement from her family. Still others were trying to deal with sexual abuse they'd suffered as children. These situations are no less storms than Ida. Some of them make Ida look like a spring rain in our lives. And they're all accompanied by fear. Storms are a reality in our lives. As I reread this passage this week, I was struck by the storms Jesus faced in this chapter. It wasn't just what was on the lake, but leading up to this point, Jesus had been through conflicts over the Sabbath. There were huge crowds who wouldn't let Jesus and his disciples alone. There was worry from his family for his sanity and hatred from his own colleagues, those religious leaders. All of this was followed by more teaching. Many came to hear him teach. Some came to be healed. There were others who came just to see who this rabbi was. We might even say in order to grab a selfie. And the result for Jesus was pure exhaustion. After Jesus fed the multitude, he sent them home and told his disciples to take him to the other side. Did you hear what the text said? The disciples took him along just as he was. It almost sounds like Jesus didn't even get into the boat by himself. It reminds me of the person who's coming out of a Phillies game with a three-year-old in their arms or over their shoulder because they fell asleep and there was no waking them. They took him just as he was back to the car. Well, they took Jesus just as he was into the boat. While it may have been Jesus' idea to go the other side, by the time they were ready to go, Jesus didn't have much say in what happened. He went. He was exhausted, and we don't often think of Jesus being exhausted. He was worn out. And so he made his way to the back of the boat. He found something to put under his head, and no sooner did he lie down than he was asleep at rest, free of the demands and the storms of demands that he'd been receiving. I remember being tired, perhaps a little bit like that, when I was on a mission trip to Nicaragua. We were taking a bus back to Managua, and it was over some mountainous areas in the back, and there was only one bus each day that left the city. We were on that bus, and so were a whole lot of others. So many, in fact, that my seat had to be on the roof, along with farm implements and things that were needed. And so I took my seat with a bunch of other men, and I put my head back, and I fell asleep on the roof of that bus, only when I woke up to discover I was sleeping on a ball of barbed wire. And I didn't care. Jesus was just that tired. As Jesus fell asleep, the text tells us that a storm arose on the lake. Many of the disciples had been through storms before. They knew what to do. It was a red alert, everyone to their station. They were all doing their part, and quite frankly, they needed Jesus to do his part too. Whether it was to bail or to row or to haul lines, they didn't wake Jesus up to stop the storm. They woke him up to do his part. But as he awoke, instead of getting a bucket to bail, he decided instead to speak to the winds and the waves. "Peace, be still." And the winds died down. The waves calmed, and the disciples were terrified. And Jesus spoke to them, "Why are you so afraid? Do you still have no faith? Or at least that's the way I hear the statement. A scolding voice. I've been with you a long time. Do you still not have any faith? That's the way I've always read this text. A scolding. And I imagine many of us would read the text much the same. Because we've heard those words in our minds over the years. Can't you ever keep your room clean? Sorry, Ma. Or perhaps it was the boss who said, how many times do I need to go over this procedure? Or the teacher whose words were, you've got so much potential. Are you ever going to live up to it? And we've heard that, and we repeat that. And so when we hear Jesus speak this way, we decide that must be what he's saying to the disciples. There's this unconscious thought in our minds that we need to be punished because we don't believe enough. We're all haunted by recordings like this, so we assume God speaks to us the same way. Why are you so afraid? Or one translation puts it this way, why are you such cowards? But I wonder, could these words have actually been an invitation from Jesus? An invitation to examine their own hearts rather than, why are you such cowards? Could Jesus have been asking, why are you afraid? What is it that's causing your fear? What are you facing that's causing this fear, my child? Is Jesus perhaps asking them to examine the root of fear in their lives? Why are we so afraid? What are the root causes of fear in our lives each day? In John's first letter to the church at large, he wrote, perfect love drives out fear. Because fear has to do with punishment. And perfect love causes it to flee. Today there are some in our community who believe their homes were destroyed, or the sicknesses they are facing are because of something they did. I remember the man who ran a little one-man sawmill up in the holler when I was in West Virginia, who was diagnosed with kidney cancer. And when I went to see him, there outside the sawmill, he said, preacher, I just don't know when I stopped thinking about Jesus long enough for that old devil to crawl up inside me. It's something I did that caused this. God's been out to get me. I don't think that's what Jesus was saying. We may be haunted by fears of punishment because of what we've done wrong. And in fact, one of the fears that's haunted me for many, many years is that one day my college, which is shut down and no longer exists except as an address for transcripts, is going to come and take back my college degree because I didn't turn in a church history paper in my freshman year. And that was a mandatory course, and I should have failed it. Is that rational? Of course not. And most of the fears that we hang on to are just as irrational. Why are you afraid? Could it be because the storms that we face are beyond our control, and we like having control? When Jesus calmed the storm, he proved to the disciples that his power was far beyond their control. And they had no idea where that power was going to take them. When we face those things that we think are beyond our control, we don't know where they're going to end up. And Jesus, in calming that storm, said to the disciples, I'm going to take you wherever I need you to be, and I'm going to do it safely. Jesus can give us calm, even in the middle of the storms, when we come to know his perfect love. As cleanup from Ida continues, we're going to be hearing how we can be part of that help. As evacuees begin to rebuild their lives in our communities, we have an opportunity to impact them and to help them find peace. As vaccines continue to roll out in our communities and around the world, we have a chance to speak Jesus' words into the storms and say, peace. Before we can speak those words, you know what we need? We need to hear them. We need to hear them in our own lives. In the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus said, "Are you tired? Worn out? Burned out on religion? Then get away with me, and you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace, for I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Keep company with me. And you'll learn to live freely and lightly." Let us pray together. Our Heavenly Father, this morning we know that there are many around us who are experiencing storms, and we'd like to be able to speak words of peace, but we also know that in our own lives, that peace is at times lacking. May we hear your words today. Peace. Be still, my child. What are you afraid of? May we learn the unforced rhythms of grace. And may we find in you all that we need, that we too may be able to share your peace with those around us. Through Christ's name we pray. Amen. We're going to share together in the Lord's table today. And this was another way that Jesus said, "Peace be still," reminding us that he's with us wherever we go. Let's join together and sing the hymn In Remembrance. And if you have not yet picked up one of the communion elements, I invite you to go to the back table and get one for yourself, or perhaps for somebody else, as we prepare to share in the Lord's table.
In Remembrance is number 322. Only one verse all the way through, and I will ask you to stand as we sing. In remembrance of me, this bread.
The scriptures tell us that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples. And he said, "This bread is my body broken for you." And they took and they ate it. When I hear that promise, it's broken for you, I hear the words, "that you might be one." We share together in one sacrifice. We share together in one bread. The bread's on the bottom of your cup. And as we take it, let us join in prayer. Heavenly Father, this small symbol is a reminder of you and of Jesus' body that's broken for us. As we share it, may we be one in your body. Thank you for your gift, for your example, and for this sacrifice. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Let us share this together. The apostle tells us that after they had eaten, Jesus took the cup and he blessed it and he said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, remember me." To remember Jesus is to find in him the lifeblood of our lives. Let us pray as we ought prepare to receive this symbol. Father, we thank you that Jesus gave his life. We thank you for the gift of salvation. We thank you that we are able to know life to its fullness because of him. Thank you for the way you turned sacrifice on its head. Rather than our offering it to you, you offered it to us. And as we receive this, may we celebrate the life we have in Jesus. Amen. This is mine. I give it to you. Let us share it. now as we prepare to go out, I would invite you to join as we sing, Send Me Out. Is with you each step of the way.